This podcast is a member of the Place to Be Nation family. Visit us at placetobenation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
Well, howdy there. Class is in, Place to Be Nation. I am JT here with episode number 10 of Jeff Learns Wrestling. And with me, as always, in the classroom is my best friend in the world, Mr. Jeff Machado. Jeff, how are you?
Good, JT. I've never done anything 10 times, so this is a big moment for me.
You lost in football 10 times.
Yes, in a row. I've never done anything good 10 times.
There you go. Okay, that works. So it has been a while. It is our 10th anniversary show, which is exciting. But I thought we'd take a minute here to talk about why we kind of started and stopped a few times with this one. We had planned to do this actually around Thanksgiving, and then we were just both really busy. And then a series of calamities kind of led us to where we are tonight and why we're doing our first ever episode via Skype and not in person. We always usually, you're here in the basement with me and we're sitting next to each other, and it kind of lends that additional personal feel, but I think we can do okay on Skype. So why don't you start with, like, a couple weeks ago, you texted me with this story about what happened at work, and then we'll go from there.
Yeah, apologies if the sound is weird over Skype, and I feel like I've been watching Survivor Series 87 for like 2 months. But basically, on Monday the 4th of December, I was at work performing my mailman duties, and I was hit by a car. That's basically the short version of the story.
But now you got to clarify. You were walking. It got hit. Like you weren't hit in the mail truck. You were walking across the street.
No, it was not. As most of my family members. Oh crap! The sandwiches are here. Pause.
Oh okay.
We'll get to the sandwiches in a minute.
Yeah, we'll get there in a second. Yeah. So all right, we're back now. Jeff went to get the sandwiches that came to his door. We'll talk about that in a moment. So continue your story, Jeff. So you weren't not hit while driving the truck. You were hit how?
Yes, I was carrying the mail. I had just parked my vehicle and grabbed the mail, so I had the most mail on me possible. I was carrying like 35 pounds worth of mail. And I was crossing Broadway, which is a very main road in Rhode Island, and some dumb bitch just, boom, crushed me with her stupid Mercury Milan, which I didn't even make anymore. And hit me right in the knees, and then I rolled up into the windshield and banged my shoulder and then fell on the back of my head and had to go to the hospital the whole nine yards. And I'm out of work for a long time. Let's put it that way.
A long time. And now I'm curious because I know obviously you're in pain, but you're a guy, we've addressed this on the show before, you worked like years at a time without like days off and shit. Like, are you secretly enjoying this extended vacation, especially during the holidays?
Yes. Actually, after the first couple days, the realization that I have to go to work during the busy season was kind of pleasant. Although, if I could go back in time, I probably would have not gotten hit by the car.
Right.
Because it is very painful to have suffered the injuries that I've suffered. Like, for example, yeah. I was supposed to go to your house and I can't even really drive, which
right. Yeah.
Kind of sucks.
Well, so to set the story there, I had initially offered to come get you, but it was going to be too early because my wife was going out and I couldn't leave the kids here. So then your fiance was going to drive you, and she had issues at school, and then you went to go drive her car, which is in what kind of condition?
Okay, so since the accident, my fiance has taken over my car, which is in tip-top shape because I am a grown adult man with a good job, and I take care of my car. She drives a piece of shit Hyundai Santa Fe, which, for all you listeners out there, if you drive a Hyundai, like, fuck you, because it all suck. And anyone who drives a Hyundai is a shitty driver. And her car has no heat, and it is snowing here, and it's been snowing for days, and she didn't leave me with a good scraper, so I couldn't even scrape off the window. And also, I can't really use my right hand, so I'm trying to, like, I was out there trying to scrape off the ice from her windshield with my left hand with a squeegee, which is the only thing I could find in my grandmother's basement, because that's my grandmother's house now. It's also a fun story. We'll tell you that later. But, yeah, I couldn't get the snow off. any of the windows, basically. And I was like, you know what? I can't go to Justin's. This podcast is doomed, and I cannot get sandwiches.
And the sandwiches were that we had ordered delicious D'Angelo sandwiches that you were going to pick up on your way here. We were going to eat, record the show, hang out, and then I was going to drive you back home. But, alas, we had to call, and I was going to cancel the D'Angelo sandwich order and told him there was an emergency, which is why you never pay in advance, people. But then,
always pay on receipt, sandwich.
Always pay on receipt. But then I talked to you, and I said, well, if you still want the sandwiches, they offered to deliver them. And you live within proximity of the place we had ordered from. I didn't. And you called back, and this nice gentleman offered to drive them over to your house. And now you have three delicious D'Angelo sandwiches.
Yes, I do. And I just thought of something. What are you going to eat for dinner? Did your wife leave you anything in the fridge? Are you going to starve tonight?
So I was planning on ordering, like, a calzone or something, like, halfway through the show to have it ready when we're done. But she went to BJ's tonight, wholesale, and we loaded up a bunch of stuff. So I'll just probably just make something homemade. And we're going out tomorrow night and stuff. So we'll, you know, I'm going to eat out tomorrow. So I'll be okay. I'll make do tonight. Thank you, though. I appreciate
it. You going to make some beefarino?
No. Probably not beefarino. Leave that for the horses. So, yeah, that's the story of how we're here. We also have some big news, though, about you as a wrestling fan, Jeff. It is official in January. You're going to be attending your first live show. Are you excited about that?
I am very excited. My father is convinced that he took me to WrestleMania at the Providence Civic Center, but you have since told me that they never had WrestleMania at the Providence Civic Center, and it was probably just some random event.
Right.
And also, I have no memory of that at all.
Okay. So you may have attended a show, but you don't remember. This will be the first one, hopefully, you remember. We'll see what kind of condition.
It'll be my first real live wrestling show where I, like, have a brain.
Right. And it'll be a lot of fun. It's actually a first. It's a 205 Live house show. 205 Live is a show that started on the WWE Network last year. It's all the cruiserweights, which is obviously the smaller wrestlers. And they're just starting to tour, like, next year. Like, that's, like, literally, like, their second show ever that we're going to attend at the University of Rhode Island. So it should be a fun time. Me, you, and Mr. D'Amato, Mr. Roger, and Mr. Brian Bayless will be joining us. So it should be a good time. We'll have to talk about it after we go.
Yeah, it's very exciting to be at the ground level of a new program, as opposed to having learned about something like 30 years prior. I get to be like, oh, this is a good show for the 205 Live. When does the first one air? Because I'll have to watch that one.
Well, it airs. Well, okay. So the live show we wouldn't be able to watch. It's just a house show that's not televised. But it airs every Wednesday or every Tuesday night on the WWE Network. Tuesdays at 10. So I'll remind you Tuesday next week, and you should check it out. I think you'll like it. It's a lot of kind of the smaller, faster paced guys. So it should be a good time.
Well, as you know, I'm a fan of the smaller, more skilled fighters.
You are. So we'll see how it goes. Any other news you want to cover? We talked about the broken arm. I didn't realize it was your right hand, by the way. How are you getting through with that? I thought maybe it was your left. That's rough.
Nope, it's my right arm. It's pretty terrible. I can't do much. It sucks to do, like, anything you can imagine that you do in your daily life. Like, mm-hmm. Showering is really painful. I actually had to convince my hairstylist to come to my house on Sunday so she could cut my hair because I can't really shampoo. I can't floss without a lot of discomfort. I can't lean down in the bed. I'm a side sleeper. I sleep on my back.
Oof.
That's probably the least fun aspect of this injury.
Yeah.
I can't really do dishes or cook, which really sucks my fiance because she doesn't like doing those things either. But I can't deliver mail, that's for sure. It's going to be a while. And let me tell you something. When you have a workman's comp case, everything, it goes smooth as peaches.
Right. That's what the word on the street is. It's just nothing. You
said
know?
Nobody ever.
Yeah. You think it'll be all right for basketball next year?
I've been calling four different offices. It's hilarious. All four offices have told me to call the other offices at least once.
Not a shock.
I mean, there's nobody in this world who's smart enough to just, like, handle a case like this. I keep saying, can we just do, like, a Google Doc? Like, jeffsinjury.com on Google?
Right.
And everyone just have access to everything?
Yeah.
But no.
No, definitely not. I mean, you're talking about the state. It's a completely, like, ass-backward state government that runs the state. So it's a tough one. It's a tough conundrum.
It's horrible. But it's better than working, and I have a good lawyer, and I have no sympathy for the bitch who hit me because she didn't even ask me who I was.
Yeah. Was she old?
She was, like, 50-something.
Yeah.
And she actually asked if she could leave the scene.
What is it with you in that? Was it when the last time you got an accent, the guy wanted to leave the scene?
Yeah. I don't know. People just think that. They just look at me and they're like, you know what? He's okay. I don't need to stick around for this crap. But she didn't ask how it was until the cops impounded her car. And she said, why are you taking my car? And this is my favorite cop exchange of all time. They said, well, because if he dies, we're going to charge you with manslaughter, and the vehicle will be the weapon, the murder weapon. And then she said, he's going to die?
Oh,
so
boy.
I'm going to sue this bitch for all she's worth.
That's great. Rob Levine?
Sadly, no. He was my third choice, though.
Okay.
But I went to a nice
the problem is your number may be blocked at Rob Levine's office. They won't believe that you're actually calling for a real case. That would have been awesome
Make
if
sure
you tried.
Next year, at the day after Thanksgiving party, that I call from like an unknown number. So I can actually get through.
Oh, boy. Yeah, that would be fantastic. It would be really funny if you tried to call and they just blocked you. And it's like, no, I really have something this time. It's a, you know, it's a real issue.
You know what, Justin? I just thought of something I feel even like worse than I did before. Not only do you not get to eat your steak and cheese, but you just use up your coupon for D'Angelo's. You got a free sub. I owe you a free sub. I got to take you out for a nice sub.
No, we're okay. Here's the secret hint. That coupon I used tonight is actually on the website. Anytime you order online, you can use that very coupon.
Two steak and cheese, get a third one free.
Yeah, it's delicious. And then if you get enough, you get points. And if you get enough points, you get $5 off. So you can get three large sandwiches for like $14 every few times.
That is amazing.
It's quite the racket.
That is like extreme couponing right there.
And they're delicious. And they're nice. They're very nice people. I'm very happy to support D'Angelo.
The best sandwich. I went to Philadelphia, and I had a Gino sandwich, and I had a Pat sandwich, and I had a street vendor steak and cheese, and my favorite steak and cheese of all time is still D'Angelo. So
there you go. You got to go to Tony Luke's.
It's going to be over, so I can eat those.
I'll be in Philly next month for the Royal Rumble, and we'll go to Tony Luke's as our place there. So we'll see how that is versus D'Angelo's. All right. We've bullshitted enough, so why don't we dive into our show of the evening. Like I said, we originally planned to do this the week of Thanksgiving, which would have been quite timely because this show aired on Thanksgiving night back in 1987, and we're getting pretty close to the end of 1987, Jeff. And if you remember, we talked about WrestleMania 3 and the fallout. I mentioned that Hulk Hogan and Andre the Giant were not yet done with their issues, and that was proven out for you here tonight, right? Because they clash yet again.
So yes, it was. And, it did not go as I expected, which is always a pleasant treat.
Awesome. So let me ask you about like the concept heading in, and then at the end I want to get your thoughts on the concept heading out. So like when we talked about this, that they're all tag matches and you kind of saw what it was, what did you think of, like were you excited to watch something of this realm, or were you kind of like, I need like a title match or a singles match or whatever?
No, I was very excited when I first got into the concept, and they were talking about there'll only be one survivor. I was like, oh, this is cool because they're gonna have all these matches, and then at the end there'll be one survivor. So at the beginning I was like 10 out of 10 excited, and at the end I was like a little bit less excited because of how it actually turned out. I thought things would happen that didn't happen.
Okay,
we'll get to that.
Yeah, I'm curious your thoughts on that as we move along. So Gorilla Monsoon and Jesse Ventura doing commentary, as always. So excited about that, of course, right?
Very excited, especially since this special opened with them being, ladies and gentlemen, here is Jesse Ventura and Gorilla Monsoon. And they actually showed them like center stage. I'm like, yes, see, they're like 50% of the excitement.
Very
much. Put them right there. It wasn't just like a normal intro. And then they just showed Jesse and Gorilla like in the booth. It's like, can you imagine that in another sport, like Joe Buck and Troy Aikman being on the 50-yard line for the Super Bowl?
Right, yeah, just the main, you know, maybe it was John Madden. Maybe you could see. He did
it
have his own
John.
Video game.
Yeah, we're here on the Super Bowl. Boom.
What do you think of a show on Thanksgiving night? Would you go to a show on Thanksgiving night?
No, and that was my second thought, because I'm like, this is actually Thanksgiving? I'm like, who watches wrestling on Thanksgiving, especially a pay-per-view? Like, who is paying for pay-per-views on Thanksgiving? Everyone just watches football. I want to see, like, numbers for this, like, episode, or if, like, every Survivor Series after that was Thanksgiving, because it doesn't make any sense to me people would actually pay money to watch something on Thanksgiving. I mean, you have to be either an entire family of wrestling fans, or if there's like one wrestling fan that's like, all I want for the year is to watch Survivor Series on Thanksgiving, you have to really love that wrestling fan.
Well, so wrestling on holidays and at that time period was actually pretty, it was like a pretty big thing. Like it happened regularly. A lot of times it was local shows, so it'd be like you'd go out to the show. But I mean, this was at night, so there was no football, because remember, back in those days, there was no night game on Thursday. So this would have been, I think, like 7 or 8 o'clock. So football's over. And, I mean, most Thanksgiving dinners are done by that time, right?
Oh, yeah. You know what? I actually didn't think about that, because WrestleMania 3 started off as like broad daylight.
Right.
So it didn't occur to me that this wasn't during the day. To me, it felt like 2 p.m. kind of thing. But if it started at night, yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
It's like, hey,
pretty sure it was Thanksgiving night. Dinner.
Yeah, okay. That makes sense.
So it's an interesting backstory to this show. The NWA, which, of course, if you watched a few matches of before, they always held their main event, Starcade. You remember, we watched a couple Starcade matches, right?
Did we?
That's where Tully Blanchard, your buddy, and
Tully Blanchard and the guy with the blonde hair.
Yeah, Magnum.
Magnum.
That's where they had their bloody match. So to fuck with them, basically, they always did their pay-per-view Starcade on Thanksgiving night. Well, Vince McMahon decided to run a show on Thanksgiving night as well, and basically
genius.
Told the pay-per-view companies, if you want to air them, I'm not going to let you have WrestleMania. So they were like, well, fuck, we want WrestleMania because it's like the biggest show of the year. So a lot of people, cable company providers, only offered the Survivor Series and didn't offer Starcade, and it ended up killing their viewership. As payback.
I love that story. He monopolized Thanksgiving.
Yeah, it became Survivor Series night. Starcade ended up moving to December the next year. But to fuck with them back, at WrestleMania, the night of WrestleMania 4, which we'll get to eventually, the NWA ran a free TV show that same night and put a huge match on it, hurting the buy rate of people ordering WrestleMania because they were watching the free show instead. So the cable companies were pissed, and they basically told the companies, like, stop fucking around. Like, we're not going to work with either of you if you keep dicking around, basically. So anyway, a little gamesmanship between the two companies. You enjoy that?
Yeah. I feel like Vince is he's sort of like a wrench in the cable company empires.
Yeah, and he's trying to take over the world.
So him.
That's how he's doing it. All right.
I respect that.
So with that all said, we get to the opening match. Randy Savage, Brutus Beefcake, Jim Duggan, Jake Roberts, and Ricky Steamboat against the Honky Tonk Man, Harley Race, Danny Davis, Hercules, and Ron Bass. I think we've covered a majority of these guys. I don't think we've talked about Ron Bass. He's probably the only one we haven't seen a matchup yet. But did anyone
that's
jump
really
out
at funny you?
Yeah, go ahead.
That's really funny because one of my first notes on this match is, who is Ron Bass? I didn't even see his intro. He's this fat fuck. Like, who is this guy? Have I ever seen him before?
You haven't. He, the outlaw Ron Bass, previously known as the cowboy Ron Bass. He was, worked around the different territories. I mean, he's a pretty solid worker even for being a bigger guy or whatever. He's just like a cowboy kind of brawler. Doesn't really have a standout run here in the WWF. He'll be around for a bit though. We'll see more of him going forward. But what did anyone else jump out at you here for guys that, you wanted to talk about individually before we get to the match?
Well, this match really made me hate Jim Duggan even more. I think I've already talked about hating Jim Duggan.
Yeah.
And he just, like, in the backstage pre-interview, he had, like, one eye half closed. It's like, oh, here, this guy's a total retard. I'm Jim Duggan, and I'm gonna blah, blah, blah. And, yeah, whatever. You suck. Also, Hercules, has he always had the chains?
No, I think it's a newer thing. I don't think, yeah, well, he had it at WrestleMania.
I was really put off by the chains, and my first thought was, are they the same chains that the junkyard dog use? Because like in Saturday Night Live, you can tell like when people were our characters, they use like the same props, and I'm like, they have just one set of chains, and now all of a sudden Hercules is using the junkyard dog's chains.
That's entirely.
They wrestle each other? Probably not, right?
I mean, they may wrestle each other. It's entirely possible they just had one chain on hand. Yeah, I didn't think of that. I think Hercules had it in the past, though. Remember, he beat up Billy Jerk Canes with it back at WrestleMania and bloodied him up. So I think he's had it for a bit now, the chain.
Oh, Billy Jack. Why don't you hurry back?
Here we go. I've already had Billy Joel in my head for this week. I don't need this one in my head as well. All right, anyone else jump out at you here of the characters?
Well, obviously, my detest for Honky Tonk Man is well documented over the course of our past 9 episodes, the very long history of Jeff Lynne Wrestling. But, oh, man, I hate this guy so much. He's like, he's talking in the pre-interview. He's like, I'm going to do what no one's ever done. I'm going to shake, rattle, and roll Elizabeth. Dude, we all know Savage has done that like a million times. Probably other people, too.
Yeah. Are you interested in trying to shake, rattle,
and roll? He's fingering his guitar. His guitar isn't even, like, playing. He's just fingering it. I couldn't tell if it was, like, an electric guitar that wasn't plugged in or if it was just an acoustic guitar and he's pretending to play it. But, man, that guy, he sucks.
Are you interested in trying the shake, rattle, and roll move?
Yes.
Okay.
I would need a lot of space, though. I don't really have a lot of space. I don't have a big bedroom here.
Yeah. Okay. So Randy Savage is now a good guy, by the way. I don't know if you picked up on this. Did they show what happened on the show? Because I realize I don't think we watched. Did we watch that? Oh, maybe we did. When Randy Savage and Honky Tonk Man and all that stuff. I guess maybe we did watch it last episode. With the guitar and he threw Liz down. I think we did actually watch it, huh?
Yes.
Okay.
So Savage basically turned face because of the Honky Tonk Elizabeth abuse.
Right. Yeah. And now he's teaming up with some of his rivals, Jake Roberts and Ricky Steamboat. And Steamboat and Jake Roberts were big rivals. Now they're teaming. So it's kind of a weird little team here, but it's kind of a super team. What did you think of Brutus Beefcake now on this face? I mean, we saw him as part of the Dream Team. We saw him split up and get left alone at the door, left off the card at WrestleMania. Now he's here as the barber pretty much fully. What did you think of that?
He didn't really add much to this match, except he just had like these crazy eyes. And I remember thinking, like, I feel bad for Jake the Snake because like Beefcake and Jim Duggan are putting their heads together and the crazy eyes, and then Jake the Snake is like chat into the camera about like, you know, trash talk and stuff, and he's probably just thinking, these guys are such idiots. Like, when is this thing over? Can I just like have a cigarette and a shot? Just get me to the bar. I felt bad for Jake the Snake. This is like beneath him, this team.
Really? You think so? I mean, he's got Randy Savage on it. You think the team is beneath him? And Ricky Steamboat.
Well, yeah, but Randy Savage is like such an obvious attempt to just like garner favor. He's like, you just made me watch like a year or two cycle of him hating the Dragon. All of a sudden they're teammates.
Yeah. Yeah, it's all confusing. I mean, we're just in an era where when you're good, you're with the good guys, and when you're bad, you're with the bad guys, and they didn't really ever, you know, explore that further. Like, I mean, there may have been stuff on TV where they like make an uneasy alliance, but it definitely doesn't play out here.
No. I didn't really buy into it.
All right, well, what'd you think of the match itself?
Well, the first thing I started to notice is that there was some like audio difficulty with this match where the mat sounded like a snare drum. And it was like really annoying to me. Anytime somebody got body slammed or like fell down, it was like this really loud sound that I think that was way off. But over the course of the show, it kind of like drowned out for me. So I got over it. But didn't have that cool like diehard slap in the cabbage fighter punch sound like most of the wrestling matches I've seen so far have had.
So maybe it was a little loose or something, possibly? A little reverb?
I think it was too tight, actually. I think they just had, it was too tight.
Okay.
And they had the microphone too close to the mat, or I don't know. But it's, it was like this bong, like every time somebody went down, which is terrible.
All right, what else you got?
Let's see, Harley Race. He sucks. I really hate Harley Race in this match.
Still against Harley?
I hate Harley. He did, they were like trying to sell him too, and his like big move in this match was he did a shoulder breaker against Ricky Steamboat, and Gorilla was like, "Oh, nailed him with it," and I rewound it three times. He whiffed on it. Like he was like a good 6 inches away from his head. It was terrible.
I feel like I have to find a really good Harley match for you, because I feel like we keep watching these ones where you pick apart and you're just getting the wrong idea of Harley. I gotta dig back and find one that you'll like.
It could be true, because all I can see, when I think of Harley, I can just go see, hear him going, "I am the king of wrestling. I am the king of all wrestling." I was like, "Fuck this guy." All he does is like tumble over the ropes as a top with his legs straightened, which is actually kind of impressive. But speaking of tumbling over the ropes, remember we've talked about Steamboat pulling himself over after getting thrown over the ropes?
Yes.
And like, "Oh man, this guy's really strong. He's like Bruce Lee." This is like the 10th or 11th time I've seen it, and it kind of started making me annoyed. It's like, dude, it's enough, you know?
So you think he does it too often? Does it lose its effectiveness then?
Yeah. It was like, it felt like one of those like NFL Combine videos where they show the guy like jumping out of the pool. I'm like, dude, I don't care that you can jump out of a pool. I don't care. Like, I can't play NFL football. I just want to see if you can run fast or if you can tackle guys. You know what I mean?
Yeah. All right. So it's not impressing you anymore. I mean, do you think it actively hurts the match, or are you just not impressed anymore?
No, it didn't hurt the match. I was just like, oh, he's going to do it again.
Okay.
I saw it coming. It was too telegraphed, as right. Jess would say.
Just,
yes. Here he comes, telegraphing a move.
Okay. All right. Fair criticism of Ricky. So Jim Duggan and Harley Race go out first with the double countouts because they're brawling around. We're not done with them. You'll see more of them in one of our next shows here. And the Brutus Beefcake eliminates the Outlaw Ron Bass. So I don't know if you have any, what your other thoughts are. I was going to go through some of the eliminations, but if you have anything on the stuff I'm talking about, just interrupt me. Honky Tonk Man then eliminates the Barber. So those are our first three eliminations. Anything you want to talk about to that point there?
Well, yeah. I mean, Duggan getting counted out was like so perfect, because if we had watched the show live, I would be saying how much Duggan was an idiot. I was like, oh, here comes Duggan the idiot into the ring, and oh no, he's out of the ring. He's an idiot, so he got counted out. So I was like, saw that one coming. Screw that guy. And then, as far as the Beefcake pinning went, that was actually kind of cool. But the Shake, Rattle, and Roll, I thought, was weak. It was like a half Shake, Rattle, and Roll. It's like he didn't really get him and shake him. He just kind of rattle-rolled him. So I couldn't tell if it was just like the fast-paced action or...
Maybe just did a little butt wiggle as the shake, just real quick, like you can't even see it.
Yeah. And then Gorilla was like, "You know, Jess, when you lose your cool, you lose the match." But I was like, that doesn't make any sense. These guys are all losing their cool all the time. Like Hulk Hogan's whole thing is that he loses his cool.
Wait, so Hogan's losing his cool? You lost me for a sec.
I'm just saying, you can't say that somebody lost because they lost their cool.
Okay, gotcha.
Losing your cool is what they all do all the time.
Okay, they're all, none of them stay cool. They all get hot.
Exactly.
Okay, that makes sense. I mean, it's just a trope to say, you know? Lost your cool and cost yourself. You got to stay in control. It's like a quarterback that looks all frazzled and scrambling around. And sure, they may complete the pass, but they lost their cool in the moment, you know? Sometimes it may cost them.
Wrestling isn't like football at all.
Could be.
You get like 15-yard penalties for stuff these guys do that's supposed to be good.
Jake Roberts eliminates Danny Davis. So you surprised that Davis hung around as long as he did?
Ah, man. He was like ruining it for me every time he was in the ring. He's like too small. Every time he's in the ring, Jake the Snake isn't that big, and he was just like throwing him around like a rag doll. He's just, like he brings nothing to the table. He's like a big old zero, big like zero, goose egg, nothing. Is Danny Davis around for a while? Because I wouldn't like that very much.
Not terribly much longer. They get some more mileage out of this whole thing. I mean, he's definitely cooled off. Like, he's not as, you know, he was really hot earlier in the year when he first did the turn, when he cost the Bulldogs the titles, and then they got the revenge at Mania and all that stuff, and he's kind of meandering around. But yeah, he's definitely now becoming just kind of a, it's kind of a jobber at this point over the next couple months for until he's done. So he's kind of done as being an important character anyway.
That's good.
Yeah. All right. So
then, as we got to the stage of the match, Hercules was like a prominent fighter, and he was kind of boring.
Yeah.
He wasn't really doing anything. He was just doing a lot of arm bars and headlocks.
Well,
there was like a good 10, 15 minutes where it was just Hercules and Honky Tonk Man putting Jake the Snake in a headlock, and I'm like, are we going to see the snake? Because he didn't bring the bag. So I'm like, the snake isn't here.
The,
I was just like, waiting for the snake all the
time. Maybe the snake was at Thanksgiving dinner.
Oh, man, that's terrible.
His little snake family. But, yeah, I mean, Hercules, if you look at that heel team, he is kind of the workhorse guy, especially with Harley gone so early. Herc's been a guy I've actually been more impressed with, like watching a lot of this stuff from 1987. I think in this match, where you're going to fill 20 minutes, and all of a sudden you're kind of down to, you know, because it was what? Those two guys went, and then Beefcake goes. So it was like 3-on-2 at that point after he eliminates Davis, Hercules. So, I mean, you get to fill some time. Herc's got to eat some time up. So, you know, he's doing what he can. He's trying. And then Randy Savage ends up eliminating him. And that leaves Honky Tonk down 3-1 against a pretty robust threesome of Randy Savage, Jake Roberts, and Ricky Steamboat. Did you feel the star power with those three guys?
Yeah, but it's kind of disappointing that Honky just ran away.
So you don't think that furthers him as like a kind of a chicken shit? Like, that's kind of his character.
Yeah, but why would they want a chicken shit to be Intercontinental Champion?
Well, the thing is that, you know, it's kind of that he stole the bell. He's kind of a worm. He keeps cheating and sneaking around and somehow, because it builds you up to say, you know, like,
I fucking hate Honky. I'm like, I've already gone over this a bunch of times, but he's in there. He's wrestling with these light blue pants. They have like musical notes on them. He says that he's the classic entertainer because he can sing, dance, and play the guitar. I've never seen him sing. I've never seen him dance. I've never seen him play the guitar. And also, he makes me like hate musical notes. He makes me hate the color powder blue. And I used to love powder blue. You know, I'm a uniform guy. I have a LaDainian Tomlinson Chargers jersey. I'm going to fucking sell that shit. Because now it just reminds me of the fucking Honky Tonk Man.
Well, but that, I think he's doing his job, though. He's making you hate him. Like, you think he's a chicken shit. You're annoyed by him. Why is he champion? Yeah, exactly. So that's what people
But there's difference between doing your job and just sucking at your job. Okay? When they introduced the Honky Tonk Man, the crowd booed, and it wasn't like a normal, like, oh, here comes Andre the Giant, or here comes Harley Race, like, boo. They booed like, no, I don't want to see this fucking guy. I just paid for my ticket. I don't want to see him ever again. Please let him not be a wrestler anymore. It was that kind of, I can tell the difference.
All right, you can tell. I mean, that's actually it's a talking point in wrestling circles, the type of heat that guys get, whether it's kind of the go away, change the channel heat, or like, I'm buying in, this guy's an asshole heat. So you're feeling like the Honky Tonk Man has changed the channel heat. You're turning it off. You know, you don't care if he loses.
Yes. If it wasn't for this show and our friendship, I would not watch a Honky Tonk Man match. I loved it when Randy Savage was a heel.
Yeah.
That guy's awesome. Obviously, Andre the Giant. I love all those guys.
So you're not chomping at the bit. Chomping? You're not chomping at the bit.
Chomping?
To see. You're not chomping at the bit to see him lose his title then. You don't care.
I hope he dies.
Okay.
I hope he like gets hit by a car and dies and doesn't even have to wrestle for the title, and they just put it up for grabs. Let two other guys wrestle for it.
All right.
I'm sorry, I'm bitter because I got hit by a car. Leave me alone.
So, if I could guarantee you there's a match where he's going to lose, you wouldn't watch it because you hate him that much, or would you watch it because you want to see him lose?
I don't want to watch it.
Okay.
Sure, he might lose, but what if he body slams Elizabeth again? And by the way, oh my God, Elizabeth.
Hachimachi?
Damn. She was the hottest I have seen her yet. She had that red dress on. It was kind of like this bustier dress.
Yeah.
Damn.
It's too bad your right hand's busted.
Hey, my left hand is nothing to sneeze at, friend.
Okay, I know. You're strong in that department, I know. All right, so Honky leaves, and we're left with Savage, Jake, and Steamboat standing tall. Did you at least like that those three guys survived? Would you like to see anyone else in there? Were you okay with that?
No, I thought it was cool that like Savage and Steamboat survived. As far as Jake the Snake, I thought maybe he would have gotten eliminated at some point because, like, why does he need to survive? Like, he's kind of a guy who can get away with losing.
Yep.
As far as Savage and Steamboat, it's like a cool like redemption story because they're such enemies.
You feel like it's like Rocky and Apollo?
Yeah, exactly. It's like Rocky and Apollo, and then here's Jake the Snake. He's like Paulie.
Yeah. it's a pretty apt comparison. If you take like 2005 Jake the Snake, it is pretty much definitely Paulie, like to a T.
He's totally Paulie. He's Paulie, only a little taller with a snake.
Well, let's hope Randy Savage doesn't die in the ring by the hands of a big Russian.
Is that like some kind of foreshadowing? Because that'd be really mean if it was.
No, I'm just making the comparison to Apollo, that's all.
Okay.
I assume he's Apollo since he was the bad guy.
Yeah, yeah. Steamboat, I guess, is Rocky.
Yeah. Even though Savage is better.
Shit, all right. Rocky, but whatever.
All right, let's get to it. Do you have anything else on that match?
No, but all right, so that was the first match, and I'm like, all right, so we got three survivors, Savage, we got Steamboat, and we got Snake. Can't wait to see these guys again later. And you and all the listeners out there know that doesn't happen, but like I said, I will save my thoughts for that.
Okay. Yeah, all right, that's interesting. Okay. It's quite the leap you took. I'm curious how you got there. So then we get to a female wrestling match with the women wrestlers. And the women's wrestlers of that day, very different than the ones of today, for multiple reasons. The match is Velvet McIntyre. Huh?
Like they haven't starred in their own pornos?
Well, they may have. They weren't leaking as easily back then. But I'm thinking it's more likely that they're just uglier and older and wrestle in bathing suits and just throw each other around by the hair. So we have Velvet McIntyre.
Because I was definitely very attracted to a lot of these wrestlers.
No, it doesn't make you a bad person. Well, let me find out which ones. Hang on. Velvet McIntyre, right. Rocket Robin, Fabulous Moolah, and the Jumping Bomb Angels against Leilani Kai, Judy Martin, Dawn Marie, Donna Christianello, and Sensational Sherry. We know you already have a fetish for the Jumping Bomb Angels, correct?
Yes, I do. And guess what they were wearing in this match before, like, their pre-match wardrobe? They
had jackets.
Some jackets that said Crazy Lover on them. Did they tell you?
Yeah.
That is like a total freak type of thing to wear.
All right, you're in on the...
That makes my hentai comments totally legitimized.
I am not looking at the hentai Wikipedia page again, by the way. Without net neutrality, I think Verizon may shut me down if I go to that page again.
First thing I noticed about this match was that Finkel was like, this is the women's elimination match, and the crowd booed. Like they booed after he said the women's elimination match. Like, were they booing the fact that they had to watch a women's match?
They could have been. Or maybe, like, Moolah was walking out and they hate her so much that they were booing her. It could have been that the heel women were coming out and they booed them, maybe? When they were, like, it was kind of...
I rewound it a couple times. I didn't see any gesture made by the heel team. I think the crowd was just like,
Women
matches.
Yeah. I mean, that was a prevailing thought in wrestling pretty much until like 10 years ago. So, it's not that off. You're probably right.
Jesus.
All right.
Really makes me angry.
So, did you find Velvet McIntyre attractive?
Yes.
What was it about her that you liked? The ginger hair?
Yeah, she was nice. She was blonde. She was cute. She was tight. She had a cute smile.
All right. How about Rockin' Robin?
Rockin' Robin was pretty in like a plain Jane kind of way.
Very plain Jane.
Very plain Jane, yeah. But yeah. I like plain Jane.
She's like extremely plain Jane, like a board. Like she's just like a board on both sides. Looks like Hacksaw Jim Duggan's 2x4 to me with hair, with bad hair.
No, she had a nice little body. I think you're not giving her a chance.
I'm all set. Moolah, did you find her attractive?
The fabulous Milfa, as I call her.
Oh, God.
All absolutely.
Right. We know your thoughts
she's
on
like
the Bomb Angels.
Rock's mom of wrestlers.
She's awful, awful person. How about the Glamour Girls, Leilani Kai and Judy Martin?
Ironically, the Glamour Girls are the least glamorous girls that
okay.
there are.
Okay. All right. So you're not into Leilani Kai, who we saw way back when with Randy Richter and Cyndi Lauper.
No, they're terrible.
Could you tell Dawn Marie and Donna Cristianello apart, or did they just kind of become one person to you?
Cristianello, I was excited for her when they announced her, because obviously I haven't seen her before. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh, maybe she has like this cool backstory. Like she was like this barfly, and she like overcame all the odds to become this great wrestler. And she was eliminated in like 2 minutes. I'm like, oh, no, she's just a nobody.
Yep, and that's it. Now she's gone.
That was it.
We never see her again.
Dawn Marie, slightly better, but a bit similar. Dawn Marie is like, if you have two twins and one of them got the good genes, she like got the good genes and Cristianello got the bad genes.
So she's the athlete and Cristianello is like the just nerd.
Yeah, she was like some biker chick who just like was stumbling down the street drunk and like, hey, you want to be in the Survivor Series? And she's like, yeah, okay.
Yeah, why not? Can I drink after? Yep. Jake the Snake. And then Sensational Sherry. Were you digging her?
Oh, my God. She's so hot.
Okay. Look at you.
You don't like Sensational Sherry?
No, I do. And she'll be around for a while. We'll see her for quite a bit. She's really talented, too. Super talented. Great in the ring, and she'll become a great manager.
She had some amazing moves. She had, like, great, she had a great outfit. Like, hot black and white pants. Damn.
Yeah. She's great. She'll be around for a while. Get used to her. All right, give me your thoughts on this one.
Well, let's see. Basically, I think this match was dominated by the Jumping Bomb Angels. Anytime they came into the ring, Gorilla and Jesse went crazy. And it really made me happy because like my fraternity for Jesse was like validated because he was just like, man, the Jumping Bomb Angels are so great. I could watch them all day. I was like, yes, that's what I'm thinking. Like, me and Jesse Ventura from 1987 should be friends.
Yeah. You guys are on the same wavelength for sure.
Absolutely. Sherry probably had the best moves. She had, like, some amazing drop kicks and some aerial tactics. But as far as the Glamour Girls, whenever one of them was in the ring, I couldn't really tell the other apart because they both just looked like some frumpy mess with, like, a big, giant blonde wig.
God, the 80s were awful for women. Like the fashion that they were forced to wear and the hair and all that stuff. Just, I feel bad for them.
I saw a sign in the crowd that said, I love Moolah. So somebody went to that show and they were on my side and they were like anti-Team JT. You know?
I feel like it's
no, Moolah is.
I feel like it's an early ironic hipster, you know, that was just into Moolah like, because it was funny. Like, oh, I'm into the grandma.
Yeah. That's probably it.
The hair, though, the Glamour Girls' hair is like the mom and the Goldbergs, you know, like it's just so like they nailed it, you know, just the fucking hairsprayed up perm and but that is really old.
It's like a wig that we would use in RSV.
Right. Very much so. Yeah, I probably have it in my closet for sure. All right. What else on this one?
I was like, these Jumping Bomb Angels are something else because my grandmother would say that all time. Like, this is something else.
Right.
Like my grandmother used to love Daniel Tosh. And she was like, oh, he is something else. And that meant like good.
Right.
And I was like, oh, all right. Gorilla knows what's up.
Yeah, he's got the lingo down. He also could not tell them apart for sure. Like 100%. He had no idea which one was which. I can guarantee.
No, exactly. They never mention a Jumping Bomb Angel by name.
Yeah, because they have no clue.
They
no fucking clue.
Every single other fighter by name, whether it's tag team, whatever. And you know what? I admit I'm slightly racist in the same way because later on the show when the Islanders are on, I can't tell the difference. But I just thought it was funny. Like, Jesse and Gorilla should know
right.
which girl is which, right? They just keep saying, oh, and what a move by the jumping bomb angel.
no idea. And it was, like acceptable then. It was like, oh, they're from the Orient, and we don't know their names. it was the 80s.
Yeah.
No one cared. Like, nowadays, you got to fucking make sure you know those names.
But I like the fact that they're so much smaller than the opponents, which brings me back to our Big Show versus Floyd Mayweather fight.
Yeah.
And I wish, like, I could watch a bomb angel against Floyd Mayweather. That would be a good match. Because he can't jump around the ring like they can.
Yeah. Are you talking like 1987 bomb angel or like today?
Well, let's meet in the middle because Floyd is, like, say 1995.
Okay.
That would have been fun. I'm guessing it never happens, though.
All right. Anything else on this one?
Not really. I mean, I thought Moolah's wrestling was interesting. It's kind of like watching a high school teacher in there, like on Halloween, because she had like this crazy costume.
Yeah.
But she looks like a high school teacher, and she's like really weakly throwing people, like body slamming people.
Does she look like super outdated to you at this point? Like she's still kind of working like this 1950s style or whatever out there, and you got like the Bomb Angels. And even Sherry kind of moving around much faster at a better pace. And, like, Moolah's still trying to do, like, the hair throws and all that shit.
Yeah. Moolah definitely was outclassed by the Bomb Angels. But Jesse made a good point because they kept grabbing each other's hair. And he's like, they just shave their heads. And it brought me back to the whole hair issue. It was kind of like the whole NFL dreadlock issue that would come up around, like, 10 years ago.
Right.
But there was my first Boston Crab. I got really excited. McIntyre, Boston Crab, and Judy Martin. She didn't actually close her with it, but
we haven't seen a
when I was a kid.
We haven't seen a Boston Crab yet.
The Boston Crab.
Oh, okay.
I don't think so.
Hmm. I feel like that's a natural move for kids. Like for kids to do, it's like easy, you know, trip someone up, grab their legs.
And... yeah, it's really easy.
The
It's like the camera is less painful in the reverse.
The, when I was a child, my sister, I think I've told the story probably with Scott, but I don't know if you've ever heard it. We went to Rock's, I want to say it was Rock's Market, and she was like over, like remember back in the day when you could trust people kind of, like they had the big like candy display and you just like walked around a little bag and like put them in the candy, like the Brock's candies and stuff.
Yeah.
So she was like middling around there and she was probably like 6 maybe or 7 and we get home and she's being like super weird and quiet, like very weird, you know, like not talking, kind of being shy, and I'm watching wrestling and I trip her up and get her in the Boston Crab, and as I'm turning her over, all this candy pours out of her pockets. She had stolen
that
a bunch of candy.
Oh man,
that's why she was being all weird and quiet, and I blew her up her spot with the Boston Crab.
You blew up her spot so hard. That's perfect.
But I feel like it was like
this
a thing.
This match actually had a great ending though, because there was like 3 great moves that like kind of finished off the whole match.
Yeah,
there was the velvet spinorama move, where girls like, round and round she goes, and where she stops, there she stops. Because he was saying it as she was spinning her. I think it was Judy. No, it was Sherry.
Yeah,
and she like just flings and stops. And then, all right, this is literally my favorite move that I have seen since my journey began on Jeff Thorne's Wrestling. The Jumping Mon Angel, A or B, I don't know. The body scissors. Do you remember this move?
Yeah.
Wow. The body scissors. She grabbed her with her legs and just started gyrating and shook the life out of her. That's the hottest thing ever.
Yeah.
That was my favorite.
Did you wish that was you?
Absolutely.
Very good. Were you surprised that Velvet, of all the people, Well, you surprised that Velvet, of all the people, beat Sherry? Because now Sherry's our champion. She beat the Moolah over the summer. the Moolah. She beat Moolah over the summer, so she's champion now. Were you surprised to see Velvet get that win, or are you kind of in on Velvet now?
No, Velvet had a great match, and I feel like this was foreshadowing something in the future, because Jesse was like, you got to believe Velvet is the favorite now for a title shot. Am I right?
No, not really. It doesn't really go anywhere. Sorry.
Oh, bummer.
But, I mean, then it's weird because they have her beat Sherry, and then she's, like, eliminated, like, 2 minutes later. You know what I mean? By, like, whatever, one of the glamour girls. So it was kind of odd. I don't know. It was a strange
last couple minutes, and it basically led up to the climax of the match, which was the Angel drop-kicking the mouth of the South.
Right.
Which was so hot. That was like Lucy Liu in Payback, starring Mel Gibson. Have you seen that movie?
Payback? Yeah, I feel like I did. What was it about?
Payback is one of my favorite movies. It's like this weird, random movie that Mel Gibson made. They film it on this blue lens, so it looks really depressing. It's like this film noir type thing. And anybody out there who has not seen Payback, you got to see it.
No, you know, so I think Mel I'm thinking Gibson. Of Ransom. I think I saw Ransom. Was that Mel Gibson too?
Yeah, but that movie sucked.
Yeah, I think that's the one I saw.
He played a father of a kid who got kidnapped.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, just post Payback. Watch Payback for our next podcast, and we'll talk about it like an intro.
Okay.
But yeah, hey.
I probably won't.
Jumping Bomb Angels survive. Of course they do, because they're the bomb.
Angels. All right, so nothing else on this one. We're good.
Yeah, that's good.
Okay.
One sad thing about this whole special is that at some point, Gorilla turned to Jesse and he's like, of course there are no titles on the line. And Jesse's like, oh, of course not.
Well, you never know.
In case you're thinking that this whole Thanksgiving Day pay-per-view has any meaning, it doesn't. It's just a total gimmick. And I was like, oh, I didn't have to say that. Like, I knew they weren't going to lose the title. It's kind of a bummer.
I guess they just wanted to make sure. I mean, back then, you know, people would send in fan mail. It was like the internet today, and get angry and stuff, and they probably don't want any false advertising claims or something, so they make it very clear so people would know. No titles are on the line in this situation.
Yeah.
Did you like Jesse's Pilgrim hat?
Jesse the Pilgrim Ventura?
Yeah.
That was my great-great-grandfather... from the body.
Oh, Jesse. So cool, but so nerdy at the same time at times. All right, so next we have a big-time match, and that is our tag team division series match. If you kind of notice the way they structured this card, Jeff, they did like kind of the intercontinental grouping, the women's grouping, the tag team group, and then the main event group. It's kind of the way they broke it up. Almost by
Actually,
division.
Actually, I hadn't noticed that until just now, but... Now that you say it, it sounds obvious, and I feel stupid.
It's okay. You're learning. There's no stupid
I was wondering
questions.
Why Honky kept saying, I'm the best intercontinental champion ever, man. Blah, blah.
Poor Honky.
I play songs from the South, and I play guitar. I got sideburns.
He's not a fan of Honky, the poor guy. He's never going to win you over. You got a ways to go with him. All right, so let's start a big tag team bout where instead of 5-on-5, it's 10-on-10. But when one member of the team is eliminated, the whole team goes down. It's the British Bulldogs, the Young Stallions, the Killer Bees, Strike Force, the Fabulous Rougeau Brothers, the Bolsheviks, the Heart Foundation, Demolition, New Dream Team, and the Islanders make the other team. So Strike Force are our tag team champions. You had asked me before, I think, if they were going to be winning, but were you surprised that they were champions here and had knocked off the Hart Foundation?
Yeah, they're kind of a lame team.
United to Strike Force?
Tito Santana and who?
Ricky Martel.
Tito Santana and who?
Come on.
Ricky Martel?
Yeah.
Ah. That doesn't sound like a championship team to me.
Okay. The chicks dug them.
Did they?
Yeah. You don't like Rick Martel?
Honestly, I couldn't pick him out of a lineup.
Okay. He's really good. All right, so they're champions. You said they're Harvard Nation.
I've seen at least three of his matches by now, and he hasn't stood out to me at all.
Yeah, I won't say we've watched any of his best stuff yet. I'll have to try and find some really good stuff. Yeah, we'll find some.
So my first impression of this match is that it's 10 on 10. And even though one elimination will eliminate two people,
mm-hmm.
it's just too many dudes.
Yeah, you didn't like. See, I kind of dig all the people on the ring and the mass of humanity. I thought it made it look really unique.
I don't know. I was looking at it at the beginning, and I'm like, there's 20 guys? There's 20 300-pound guys around one little tiny ring? I don't know what's happening.
Yeah, you find it hard to keep track?
Who's the referee?
Who cares about the referee?
I care about the referee. Without rules, we have chaos.
That's true, as a wise man once said. Any other teams that were new for us here? Well, we have the new Dream Team, of course, Dino Bravo.
I've never seen the Young Stallions before.
Did they look like stallions to you?
They look young.
Yeah. Paul Roma and Jim Powers.
Yeah, they were in the ring like the entire match. And they got more criticism than any team I've ever seen before. Both Gorilla and Jesse. They were like, these guys are outmatched. They're not prepared today. They're just letting their team down. They're getting their asses kicked over and over and over again.
You think they were overdoing that on purpose to, like, then when they won, to make it, like, a big surprise?
Yeah, I didn't see that coming. It was actually a pretty good setup.
Yeah, they weren't really that great. Like, they were kind of like, they're probably like the lowest rung team of this match when you look at like the way they're positioned. So, it was a bit of an upset when they won. So, what do you think of the Bolsheviks? Iron Sheik is gone. He was fired. And Boris Zhukov is in with Nikolai Volkov now.
Wait, he was fired? Like, really fired?
Yeah, so he got bagged with Jim Duggan on the New Jersey Turnpike driving together with coke. And the coke wasn't the big offensive issue. It was the fact that they were feuding at the time and got caught driving a car together, and it made the news. So
they kept looking, they fired Sheik?
No, so they both got fired. This was like in May. And then when things cooled down, they brought them both back. And then Sheik, they ended up just pushing out anyway. They were kind of done with him. I figured if he fucked up again or what. And they brought back Duggan because they wanted Duggan. So it was kind of like, all right, you guys are idiots. Take a couple of months off. You know, let the shit cool down. Then we'll bring it back quietly. But it was quite the story. Idiots.
That's crazy because nobody cares about coke now. You could totally do coke and nobody cares.
Well, I mean, if you get pulled over and it's in the car, you probably get in trouble.
Yeah, I guess.
I think it was more acceptable.
Unless Duggan was an idiot.
I think it was more accepted in the 80s, anyway, than now. Demolition, we haven't talked about. What did you think of them?
I had, like, some mild childhood memories of the Demolition.
Yeah.
Are they the first, like, super crazy face paint guys to come on the scene?
In the WWF, they are. They're kind of a knockoff of the Road Warriors / Legion of Doom, who were, like, huge right now in the NWA. This is kind of WWF's answer to them. So here, they're pretty much the first big, like, monster face-painted team. I mean, there's probably been others around, but of this era, they're the first. And they kind of get the S&M stuff on with the studs and all that shit, so.
Yeah, I thought it was weird. I thought it was, like, Sesame Street, like one of these teams is not like the other.
Did that make it better though? Like, did they stand out more for you that they didn't really blend in? That it made them look unique?
Yeah, it was cool. It was like more exciting when one of those guys got in the ring.
Yeah. Okay. All right. What are the notes you have on this one?
Is Jesse Ventura actually from Minnesota? Because I know he ends up being governor of Minnesota.
You know, that's a good question. I feel like he's from California, but hang on, I can check. Why do you
Because
ask?
During this match, I think he's actually talking about Axe's match, but Gorilla was like, oh, what about when Axe kicked a guy behind his back? And Jesse was like, I didn't notice.
Yeah, he was born in Minneapolis, yep.
Oh, sweet.
There you go.
That was the first time ever that he just let his Minneapolis accent slip.
Yeah, he's good at hiding it.
It's kind of like Mel Gibson. Like, Mel Gibson was from Australia, and he, like, acts with an American accent, but if you catch, like, some weird time in earlier movies, he sounds like Australian.
Right. It's like Nicole Kidman.
Fascinating. I thought it was funny that Volkov lost the first 30 seconds.
Yeah, he's they're down the it was a minute 44. Yeah.
Whatever. Like, we're going to get rid of the Russians right away. Let's play the rest of the match. It was like such a dumb pinfall too.
Well, it's like they're punishing him for what happened with Iron Sheik. They're saddling with Borzukov and eliminate him quickly.
The Rougeaus kind of sucked in this match.
Yeah.
Although I was impressed with their hair because they didn't have any like hair product in, but they weren't getting sweaty.
Were they working hard? Maybe they just weren't working. Maybe the heart rate wasn't up.
Yeah, they were jumping all over the place.
Maybe they're in such good cardio shape that it doesn't matter. You know what I mean?
Could be. But they got pinned pretty quick. Axe just basically fell on Jock and he pinned him. He's like so dumb. He didn't do anything. Actually, he didn't even fall on him. He just kind of like got out of the way while Jock was flying through the air and he just fell down and he pinned him.
Yeah. Got the wind knocked out of him.
Yeah, fine.
That was 6 minutes in.
The funniest part about watching this was that the first time that one of the Islanders came into the match, my Chihuahua jumped up from sleeping on the couch and started barking at the TV.
What are you trying to say?
Well, I'm trying to say one of two things. Either racism is like instinctual, or there's some kind of like deep-seated rivalry between Mexico and Hawaii.
I want you to do this. I want you to take this story about the dog not liking the Islanders instinctually, okay? I want you to file it away in your brain for a little bit. Okay?
Okay.
All right. That's all I'm saying. Just don't forget it.
Gotcha.
Okay.
I won't.
Do you like the Islanders? I know you can't tell them apart, but do you like them?
No.
Okay.
They're boring.
They're boring?
They don't do shit. They just get hit in the head, and then the racist commentators, who I'm trying to like, say things like, "Oh, you can't hit them in the head. They're from the islands." Doesn't make any sense. Okay? I'm from Cranston, Rhode Island, and I have the hardest head of anybody I know. You can hit me in the head as many times as you want.
Yeah. I mean, it's just a thing. The black guys and the island guys all have the thick skulls. It's just, it's not just Gorilla and Jesse. It's pretty much just a wrestling thing throughout the 80s and even into the 90s.
How'd you feel about Hammer in this match?
I hate the new Dream Team, and I think he was like really done with it. You know what I mean? Like, I think he was ready to be on his own again. And I don't think it's too long after this that they split up too, and he pretty much says it. He's like, "I'm ready to go out on my own." He kind of lugged around Beefcake for like 2 years. Like, now he's saddled with fucking Dino Bravo. So I think he's ready to just cash out. But he's always great. Like, I always enjoy him in the match, any match he's in. I don't think he ever half-asses it. I liked him in this one, but the team themselves were just blah, blah.
Have I seen Dino Bravo before? Because I don't remember him at all.
No, I think he's new. Well, he was at WrestleMania. He's the one that took Beefcake's spot. Remember, he helped them win the match, and then they left. They left Beefcake in the ring.
Oh, yeah.
But you haven't seen him wrestle. He's awful. He's legitimately like one of the worst wrestlers you're going to see.
Yeah, he just like popped up like halfway through the match. I'm like, who the fuck is that guy? I'm like, oh, it's Hammer's partner.
Yeah, he's
but
terrible.
I don't know. Hammer looked kind of old in this match. Like, he tried to suplex the Stallion, one of the Stallions. I can't tell the two of them apart. But he sort of like, it was like a 45-degree suplex. It was kind of embarrassing.
Yeah.
Is Hammer on the way out?
Nah, he'll be here for a little bit longer, but I mean, you know, he's been going at it for a long time now. He's getting up there, and he's got a lot of miles on the old body. He's a workhorse, so he might have been wearing down a bit, getting a little tired.
Right.
Made us ate a lot of turkey. Tryptophan was kicking in.
Uh,
Maybe Dino Bravo fed him extra turkey so he could play with his toys.
Yeah, I guess he was just having an off day.
That episode of Seinfeld aged not too well, huh? Where Jerry drugs the girl and plays with the toys.
Oh, because of all the Hollywood stuff?
Yeah. Yeah. Bill Cosby.
He doesn't rape her. He just plays with her toys.
Well, that's like Jerry's version of rape, though. You know what I mean? Like, he's like an innocent man-child in that show.
Yeah, I mean, I guess you can still probably go to jail for that.
Yeah. It's a little too gleeful when you look back at it.
Although, is convincing a woman to drink wine wrong?
Well, he's like force-feeding her a turkey. And don't they actually give her a pill? Isn't it at the end of the scene, don't they, like, he goes and finds, like, a sleeping pill or something?
That, I don't remember, but...
I feel like that's in there somewhere.
That would be, that would be the clincher.
All right, if we ever finish the Seinfeld rewatch series, we'll see that one in season 9. We made it to season 9, and that's when we fucking crapped out, so we gotta finish. But imagine making it that far. We got, like, 2 episodes into season 9, and, life just got in the way, and it's one of those things where once you don't do it for, like, a couple weeks, it's hard to get back to it, you know? So
I thought for sure you guys would be done by now. That's crazy.
We should have been, by far. I mean, yes, easily. But we just have been too... It's just so hard to, like, get back on the horse.
What was the highest rated episode thus far?
I'd have to go back and look. There was a few that got straight 10 out of 10. The contest, I think, for sure. I don't know. I feel like Greeny put together, like, a spreadsheet. I can see if I have it.
There was a moment in this match that really struck my chords. There was, I don't know if you remember, but the hitman was going after, I think, maybe, actually I forgot who he was going after, but the guy ducked out of the way and he hit the steel post with his shoulder.
Mm.
He really hit it. Like, it made my shoulder hurt. It reminded me of myself getting hit by the car. And also, you remember in, like, 1994 when the U.S. goalkeeper got hit, like, was diving to save a ball and he hit his shoulder against the post and he broke his shoulder?
Vaguely.
I forget his name, but that was, like,
Freddie Adu.
One of those, ooh, because sometimes you're watching it and you're like, oh, that guy really got hurt. Is there any, like, Brett get hurt in this match?
I don't think so. He is just really good. Brett is one of the all-time best at, like, making shit look real. You know what I mean? Like, he was really, really good at it. Like, he would take sick... Like, another one of his big ones. I don't know if we've seen one in any of these matches yet. He gets whipped into the corner, chest first, and, like, slams his chest off the top turnbuckle. Like, that's a sick move he does all the time, too. And he was just one of the greats at, like... You know, his offense and getting hit always look great, even though they never really hurt anyone. He was really good at that.
Huh. So maybe it was just talent.
I think so. I think he fooled you.
Good for him. I'm looking forward to more Hitman in my future.
Oh, you're going to see plenty of the Hitman as we move forward. He is not going away. He's always reuniting the Heart Foundation.
So yeah, then they knock out the Strike Force, which I thought was kind of a dubious ending for the because I think Santana was about to pin Brett. And then the Anvil comes in and just, like, kicks him. And then Santana gets pinned. Isn't that illegal? Like, can't you just not come in and, like, hit somebody?
Well, if the referee's not looking, you can't. Well, actually, you have 5 seconds to double team in a tag match. So you can, but you got to get out of the ring in 5 seconds.
Yeah, so that was kind of a bummer. So Strike Force is out.
Were you surprised they treated the champs like that? Just middle of the match, they're gone?
Yeah. It wasn't even like the finale. It was like a douchey last move. So then you got who's left? We got the Stallions, the Heart Foundation,
Islanders,
the Bulldogs.
Yep.
The Islanders.
What are your thoughts on the Bulldogs here? You still digging them at all?
The Bulldogs might be the most imbalanced team that I've seen. Because Davey Boy is impressive, but Dynamite, not so much.
Really? You don't like Dynamite? Well, we're looking at late era Dynamite at this point. His back was like toast by earlier 87. He's like barely holding it together during this time. Older Dynamite, which we've seen some of, like when they fought the Dream Team, like that Dynamite was really good.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen him in a couple matches, but like in this match, he's basically running in and running around the guy he's fighting. He gets slammed a couple times, and he tries some desperation move, and he tags out, whereas Davey Boy is just like grabbing Bret Hart and lifting him up over his head.
Right,
like
yeah.
Nothing.
I think that's just a result of not being healthy. His back was just gone.
Yeah, it could be.
No, I probably definitely.
I'm sorry to all the Dynamite fans out there. I don't mean to shit on him or anything. I just...
Yeah, it's okay. This is your opinions. You can be... You say what you want. No one's right.
Yeah, it's like...
Unless we disagree on stuff like Lou Albano. What, or George Steele, whoever it is that you love that I hate. Alright, so what else on this one?
Let's see, what else we got? So, Hammer goes out. Roma pins Hammer. We had some more sexual innuendo from Gorilla, which is pretty great.
What'd he say?
Anvil has too much leg strength to get caught by a small package.
It's true.
Front face locked by the Hammer. Only way you can get him back there. Am I right?
Yeah.
I don't know about the face lock. I want to get back there. But yeah, so now you got just everybody's out who I thought would be in the finale. You know, you got like the Hitman gets pinned by one of the Killer Bees. It's crazy. And I think one of the Killer Bees separated his shoulder.
You think so?
Which made me feel bad about myself. I'm like, I can't even drive to my friend's house to do a podcast. This guy's wrestling. This guy's wrestling with it.
The
yeah,
the Bees and the Hearts were kind of always like an ongoing feud, so this is kind of like a nice little win for the Bees finally getting over. But it was surprising that they had the Hearts beat the champions and then lose to the Bees. Kind of like earlier with Sherry losing to Velvet and the Velvet falling. They're kind of treating the champions weird on the show.
Yeah, but I do remember when Bret Hart got tagged out, I broke my phone out. I started playing chess. And that might be the first time in all these episodes you made me watch that I'm like, you know what? This match is just too long. I'm not even going to pause it. I'm just going to go on my phone and fuck around. There's like too many teams.
Interesting.
And now the Hearts are out. Strike Force is out. Axe and Smash are out. We have the Killer Bees. We have the fucking Stallions who have been raided by Jesse and Gorilla the entire match for being overmatched. I can't tell the two of them apart. Never seen the guys before. And you got the Islanders who are just like doing like weird wampum chats, whatever, the fucking no shoes. Put some fucking shoes on.
God, you hate everyone.
And I thought it was weird when you and Chad Campbell, made me watch that Killer Bees match. I'm like, the Killer Bees, they're never going to be good. They're never going to be anything. And who gets the pin to win the match? The fucking Killer Bees, because they cheated. The Killer Bee outside the ring puts a mask on.
Yeah, the mask. The mask magic there.
Unbelievable. Faces become heels. Heels become faces. Jesse says, that's a bunch of crap.
What do you think of the faces?
It's so funny that he said crap because it's pay-per-view. He could have just said shit. But there's no swearing. There's like more swearing on like a 1 p.m. NFL or NBA podcast than there is on a pay-per-view wrestling. It's amazing.
What did you think of like the faces having... This is the second time now, or the third time really, where the faces had the advantage at the end. Like normally you would have the heels have the advantage and the face battles back. You know what I mean? But this is now the third match where the heels have been outnumbered down the stretch. Does that surprise you at all? Did you notice that?
Yeah, I thought like, all right, so you have Randy Savage and a bunch of bums against a bunch of bums. So I figured maybe it would be like Randy Savage against like Honky Tonk Man, Hercules, and Harley Race, and then he just beats them all, and it's like, oh, yes, this is right. Randy Savage just beat all these. Oh, it's just like, all the guys that nobody really cares about gets eliminated, and then Honky Tonk Man runs away. Or like the Jumping Mom Angels are just there because they're it's impossible to beat them. Which, you know what? That makes sense. But now you have the Bees and the Stallions, and like the Heart Foundation is gone.
Mm-hmm.
And Axe and Smash is gone. Then it makes no sense.
Yeah. Well, I guess they were going for the underdog story.
Yeah.
All right, anything else on that match?
I didn't understand the concept of the Survivor Series. Like, how could there be more than one Survivor? Shouldn't the Bees and the Stallions have to now wrestle?
Well, no, it's just a team trying to win. You're trying to eliminate all the other members of the other team. That's it.
But what do you get? What do you get for winning? Nothing.
You get more money than the losers. Pride. A win, a notch on your belt to move up the ladder.
All right, so Team Strike Force wins over Team Heart Foundation, even though Team Strike Force got eliminated.
Right, well, they put together a superior team. As captains.
Okay.
So you didn't like that match, huh?
It was just so long. I felt like
it was a half hour.
I felt like it was 2 hours long.
Yeah, it was a half hour. So our buddy Jason Greenhouse sent me over the spreadsheet of the Seinfeld stuff. So we're through season. We got like one episode in a season 9, basically. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 episodes got perfect scores, meaning me, all five of us gave it a 10, 10 out of 10. Any guess at the? I already gave you one.
50?
Hmm? Average. Well, he did like the average score. Yeah, it was a 50, whatever. He did like the average score, so it was all a 10. Average is a 10. So I already gave you one, was the contest. Can you, you think you can take a quick shot at the other four?
The Hamptons.
Nope.
The Chinese restaurant.
Nope.
How many guesses do I get?
A couple. The Hamptons got a 8.2 average. It was at 8.7899.
That's like my favorite episode. What's the matter with you guys?
Chinese restaurant got a 7.4.
Dealership.
No, we didn't get to that one yet. It was season 9.
Oh.
Think there's like one big one.
The puffy shirt?
Was that the opposite? I think it is. So yeah. Right? When George starts doing the opposite, isn't that the puffy shirt? Yeah, it's easy, it becomes the hand model. Oh no, is that a different one?
No, the puffy shirt is a puffy shirt.
Okay. No, that got a 9.6. Aaron gave it an 8.
Alright, so the opposite, obviously.
Opposite is the second one. Yep.
The marine biologist.
Yes. That's what I was saying. It was a big one. Two more. One had a very infamous guest role.
Oh, Terry Hatcher.
No. Very infamous guest role, like with a catchphrase. No.
The catchphrase?
The boyfriend got a 9 average. It had a catchphrase, not the catchphrase. The character that makes the episode had a catchphrase that became like a popular catchphrase.
It wasn't they're real and they're spectacular?
No. Think more simple than that.
Give me a hint.
No soup for you!
Soup the Nazi. Soup Nazi got a 50?
Yeah, that's a great episode.
It's got not.
Yeah, it's got the gay guys with the armoire.
That episode is like 10 minutes of good stuff.
Yeah. All right, one more.
The Schmoopy Girl is terrible. The Schmoopy Girl ruins it.
All right, one more.
Your list has no legitimization. Give me like a season or something.
I think it's season 6.
Season 6.
Here are the ones that just missed a 10. The Doorman, the Yada Yada, the Bubble Boy, the Outing, Puffy Shirt, Cigar Store Indian and the Raincoats, and the Chicken Roaster and the Showerhead. Those all got like 9.6 and above.
Kenny Rogers is a good one.
I gave almost all of those 10s, the ones I just listed. I also gave the Doll a 10, the Bizarro Jerry a 10, the Race a 10, the Voice a 10, the Rye a 10.
Oh, the Voice was my The Voice is definitely a 10. What was the average on The Voice?
9.2. Andy gave it a 9.
All right. So season 6, give me a hint.
Frank Costanza plays a big role.
Oh, the Korean chef thing?
No, it's the Fusilli Jerry.
Oh, right. The Ass Man.
Yep. The lowest, any guess at any guess at the lowest rated?
Lowest rated? Was it the Invocation Wedding?
We didn't get to that one yet.
Oh, right. Was it the premiere?
It was The Robbery, 2.4. Was
the guy
that
the
one?
Statue?
I think that's that one, yeah. The pilot, the Seinfeld Chronicles.
Happy.
The Seinfeld Chronicles got 2.8. Baby Shower, 2.6. A Stock Tip, 2.8. It's all the early ones, pretty much, or like the bottom of the barrel.
I like the Stock Tip. You guys got the
sweater.
Sniffles?
Yeah. That got a 2.8.
You guys are harsh.
Yeah. It's a Seinfeld scale. I gave the Van Buren Boys a 10, by the way.
Nice.
That's a good one. All right. Spent enough time there. Why don't we get to, before our main event, we have a Ted DiBiase. We visit with him, celebrating Thanksgiving, driving around town, eating a meal. Any thoughts on the premiere of Ted DiBiase here?
This might have been the worst 7 minutes of my life.
God. You did not like this show, huh?
You know what? Now that I think about it, I didn't love it.
All right. What was it about DiBiase you didn't like?
All right, let's start with the segue. Okay, so the Killer Bees win. Speaking of Thanksgiving, all the people I'd want to see how they'd spend Thanksgiving, I'd want to see Ted DiBiase. And then this fucking guy do this stupid segment with terrible acting, just count. Nobody just holds $100 bills and slowly counts them. It's like the WWF had like $1,000 and $100 bills, just gave them to Ted DiBiase every time he had to do a fucking segment. It's like, it doesn't matter. You don't need to be counting money. I could grab $1,000 bills. It doesn't matter, okay? Because I need to pay like my bills with them.
But you care about it. See, he doesn't care about it. That's what he's showing you. He can just throw this money around and not give a fuck because he's.
They make a friggin' black kid dribble a basketball. The white kid gets to do push-ups. The black kid dribbles a basketball. You think that's fair? All I could think about was the song "Christmas Shoes." Ted DiBiase is not buying any Christmas shoes for that kid. He's just going to let the mom die with no pretty shoes. It's terrible. Everyone's like, oh my God, Ted DiBiase has $300 to $400 to give me. I'm going to do whatever he says. I'm going to shut down a public pool. Why would a millionaire want to go to a public pool? Doesn't he have his own cool pool, like his own lagoon style pool?
Because he can. He's an asshole millionaire. He can throw the kids out. He's just a prick.
So fine, he's an asshole millionaire. So why are we giving him airtime? Are we setting something up? What does this have to do with Survivor Series?
Well, yeah, he's going to be coming into the company soon. This is they're debuting him by showing off what a asshole he is. So when he comes in, you know, to boom.
I honestly wanted to stop watching at this point, but I was like, you know what? I'm committed to Place to Be Nation, and I'm committed to Justin.
I'm trying to figure out if you really didn't like
the
show.
All the Jeff wrestling fans out there.
Trying to figure out if you didn't really like the show or if you're just in pain and it's seeping through to your thoughts. You know what I mean? If it's the arm.
It's a combination of a whole bunch of things, okay? It was this show, follow-up episode of WrestleMania 3. I'm in pain. I can't drive. I can't do anything. I can't wash my hair. All right? I'm alone. The dogs are driving me crazy. My girlfriend's car is a piece of shit. And
you get three sandwiches.
I would like to be able to sit down and not watch Ted DiBiase from 30 years ago brag about how much money he can not pay to a little black kid to dribble a basketball. Tuesday.
What's the over-under on how many sandwiches you'll probably eat tonight from those three that you got?
I'm eating all three of those before Brittany gets home. And I'm not even going to tell her that I got them. Because I know for a fact she's not going to listen to this show, so I won't feel bad about it. She'll come home and she'll say, I'm hungry. And she'll say, how many cookies, something? And I say, no, I'm not that hungry. Some pain meds. You make yourself something. And I'll be sitting there smiling my fucking ass off because I just ate 3-foot-long subs from D'Angelo's. And I'm not even going to tell her about it. And then maybe someday when we're really old and I'm dying, I'll tell her, joke's on you. I could have saved you a sandwich, but I didn't because I was mad because I couldn't get to Justin's house that night.
If you're dying when you're really old, that's a big win for you.
You know what? That's funny. People say that to me all the time. I have this mojo about me where people think I'm going to die before like I'm 40, which doesn't give me much time.
That's the way you carry yourself. You didn't like DiBiase's line that I pay more in taxes than people make in a year?
No, that's not that impressive.
Okay.
If he pays, or think about Fred Mickelson, for example. Like, he wanted to move out of California because taxes are too high. Like, yes, it's clear that he pays more in taxes in a month. If he had said in a day, that would be more impressive.
Okay.
In a month, I mean, yeah, you're either rich or you're not.
All right, so Gorilla and Jesse then kind of talk about the night, and then Craig DeGeorge talks to the Honky Tonk Man. Do you just want to ignore that, or do you have anything to say there?
Is that when the Honky Tonk Man was like, I got the whole package, I don't care what these people think?
Yeah, I think so. And he challenges Hulk Hogan.
Yeah, Honky Tonk Man is such a loser. I, Jeff Machado, have won 3 karaoke contests. I bet at the time that guy was talking, he has never won one. So fuck him.
You also do a great Billy Joel.
Yeah.
As we'll find out.
Well, that is to be seen.
Heard.
Stay tuned for future Place to Be Nation broadcasts.
All right, let's get to the main event. Hulk Hogan, Ken Patera, Don Morocco, Bam Bam Bigelow, and Paul Orndorff taking on Andre the Giant, Butch Reed, the One Man Gang, King Kong Bundy, and Ravishing Rick Rude. So quite a few new faces for you here that we haven't seen before. We have Ken Patera, who was a former Intercontinental Champion, was a big-time heel, went to jail because he got really angry one night outside of McDonald's. And because they were closed and he wanted food, he threw a cinder block through the window and got arrested.
Like real in real life?
Him and Mr. Saito, yep. They got into like a fight with cops after he threw a fucking thing through a window. Real life. So he went to jail for like whatever, 2 years. Came back. And he became a face. They made it like part of his story that he was like redeemed and back. And so here he is here tonight. Any thoughts on Patera?
Well, I had a bunch of notes on him, but I'm just throwing them all out the window because I officially love him. He's like my new favorite character.
Did you like his hair?
Angry at McDonald's. I love McDonald's like above anything. I had no idea. I actually remember Jesse made a comment about, oh, at least he's not in jail. And I like just ignored him. But he actually went to jail for wanting McDonald's. That is amazing.
Yeah. Man. It's true. What
for our next episode, I'm going to start the episode with like a soliloquy. I want to do research on this guy.
Okay. We can just do a whole episode on Ken Patera if you want.
Really, the only thing I was going to say about Patera was that his uniform sucked.
Well, what'd you think about his hair?
His hair was pretty bad too. There was a bunch of time in the match that he was in the ring with the One Man Gang. Who, by the way, is that Hakeem?
Yes. Good eye. Look at you.
The same guy?
Yeah.
You can just change personalities?
Well, we'll see. Really quickly, Patera, did it look to you like he had like tights on his legs? Like that's how smooth his legs looked?
Yeah, yeah.
It was weird, right? It looked like he had like nylons on.
Yeah, it was weird. It was like he either shaved or he had some kind of like Spanx. But like, the One Man Gang's outfit was awesome. It was like this cool, like black getup thing, and he had like tattoos and a mohawk. And this guy is wrestling in this like lame, sparkly United States Olympic singlet. It was like watching the Chicago Bears against the Houston Texans. It's terrible.
Here's a story: on April 6th, 1984, Patera and fellow heel Masa Saito were denied service after hours at a McDonald's in Waukesha, Wisconsin, Steve Willey will correct us. Kesha, Timber. Prompting an angry Patera to throw a rock through a window of the building. Patera claims later that a former employee threw the rock, but he received the blame. He and Saito were assaulted the policemen that were sent to arrest him later at the hotel, and he got 16 months later, he was sentenced to 2 years in prison. So there you go.
2 years?
Yeah.
Oh, man. Is he still alive?
Yeah, he is.
I would love to contact this guy.
He's
because
been
I used to live... McDonald's is my favorite place in the world, and I used to live a block away from McDonald's. So at night, I would crave a McFlurry, which is their, like, you know, soft serve ice cream with stuff mixed in it. So me and my girlfriend would go to McDonald's, but they always would say that the ice cream machine was broken, which is impossible because it's not that hard to make ice cream. They were just cleaning it early. They were open till 11. So I would get so like enraged, but I didn't have the kind of like financial backing of this guy, Patera, so I didn't have any balls. But I wanted to throw a cinder block through the window because they would never give me my McFlurry. I'm like, who goes to McDonald's? I'm only here because I want a McFlurry. And you can't just shut the machine down before 11 o'clock. If you're open till 11 o'clock, you have to have all your menu available until then. And it made me so angry, like, every time. This guy's, like, my best friend now.
Well, he's 75, and he's been divorced 3 times. So there you go. Ken Wayne Patera.
Kindred spirits.
He is.
Kindred spirits.
All right, so enough with Ken and his hairless legs. Don Morocco, we've talked about. Bam Bam Bigelow's a newcomer. Have you ever heard of him?
Bam Bam Bigelow. I have heard of him, but... those are the three words that come away for me for this match and the entire show.
Yeah.
Like, wow.
You impressed?
Wow. So impressed. Like, I love this guy.
What did you like about him?
Well, I like his look. I like his skill. I like how everything comes together at the end. I mean, he's what, 400 pounds?
Yeah.
He's like zipping all around the friggin' ring. He's doing somersaults. He's like a ballet dancer.
He's like Jay on the basketball court.
Yes. He is like our friend Jay, who plays football and basketball with us, who is overweight but athletic.
Yeah.
In a surprisingly dominant way.
Yeah.
I love Bam Bam.
Doing cartwheels. So he came in and did this big thing where like all the managers were going for him. And they ended up bringing in a new manager, who's Sir Oliver Humperdinck, who's at ringside here during this match.
Yeah, I saw this Humperdinck guy. I didn't actually like think about him.
Right.
Like, you know what? I'm just going to ignore that guy. He's not doing anything. He's not like Bobby the Brain or the Mouth. He's just kind of there.
Yeah, just kind of
exists. So we'll get to that later, I guess.
Okay.
If we have.
All right, why don't you talk about your notes here, and then if you miss anything of any of the guys I wanted to cover, we'll go back to it. So, go ahead, share your thoughts.
All right, so I was very excited at the beginning of this match. You know how much I love Andre. Also, Andre has really great hair, which I'm surprised I never noticed until now. He's got like this big curly coif. He's kind of like he's got like John Ferry hair.
He does. He does have John Ferry hair. You're right.
Which sadly nobody else would know except you and me. But
he's also broken down like John Ferry.
Yeah, I didn't like Hogan's new look. He had like this headband thing that was frilled and like draped over his eyes.
Mm.
It was like a reverse headband. I didn't get it.
I think it's a little too crazy for him.
Very diva move.
Yeah.
Jesse mentioned that the referee was Joey Morella.
Mm-hmm.
He referred to him as a nasty little Joey Morella, and then I couldn't remember why that was significant.
Well, he was a referee at WrestleMania 3. Do you remember that?
Oh, the 2.5 count guy?
Yeah.
All right, that makes sense.
But he's also Gorilla Monsoon's son, so Jesse always makes jokes about it like that. Like, he doesn't say it, but that's why he always busts on him.
Oh, like in real life?
Yep.
That's hilarious, because I thought it was like a really mean thing to say. It's like, that nasty little Joey Morella.
Yeah, he's basically just trolling Gorilla.
Inside jokes are funny. Let's see. basically Rick Rude gets in there and he's gets his ass kicked a bunch of times. Is he like newish at this point?
Yeah, he had just come in not that long before this. Did you like him?
He had really
good like
pants on. Well, I don't know what you're trying to say.
Did you like his look as a wrestler? He's jacked up. He's got the long mullet. It's kind of the 80s look, the mustache, you know? Is he ravishing?
He's in good shape. He has low body fat. I would like to see a comparison between him and Hercules. They're both very, very well put together.
Mm-hmm.
But his pants were interesting. He had like stoplights on his pants.
Yeah, he's known for his pants designs. We'll see.
Didn't really get that. He didn't really have any signature move or anything. He basically just started the match and got beat up for a really long time.
Yeah, kind of the new guy getting put through the motions. He does hang out for a bit, though. He eliminates Paul Orndorff, who this is the last time you're going to see Paul. He's back to being a face again. Came back crawling, friends with Hogan again. And this is pretty much it for him.
Hogan drops the leg pretty early, which, you know, my sense of drama. I don't like to see things like that happen so early.
Right.
Kind of ruined it. And it's kind of like Volkov getting eliminated. It's like, all right, let's get rid of the Russians. Let's get rid of the black guys.
Yeah, just eliminate the token black guy.
Yeah. All right, so Reed's out. And then he goes over and he's high-fiving everyone. And all of a sudden, Andre comes in the ring. I'm like, all right, here we go, Hogan and Andre. And the referee's like, no, you tagged out. And I'm like, wow, I never thought to ask this before. But is high-five a tag? And I guess it is.
Probably depends on the match. But the rule generally is if you touch hands and the guy's holding the tag rope in the corner, it is a tag. So whoever he did the high five to that came in next was probably holding the tag rope, I'm guessing.
Yeah, well, the referee ruled that Patera was the legal man.
So I wonder, did he high five him first or was he maybe just holding the rope? I'm curious.
I think he did high five him first.
Okay, so that's why.
I didn't see any tag rope in his matches.
Hmm. Yeah, I guess maybe there's no tag rope because there's so many guys. I don't know. Yeah, I guess he was the first one he touched, so he said that's it. He touched hands. It was kind of shrewd, though, right? Because he gets you pumped for Hogan Andre, and then you kind of they swerve you.
Yeah, so Andre goes out, and the gang, and Patera, and the gang beats him by falling on him.
He's a big guy.
Which is, you know, it goes back to my Bundy Hogan matches. Like, oh, yeah, just fall on him, and he's dead. All right. Can't teach size, I guess. Then Jesse was all over Rick Rude. He was like, he's on his game tonight. He's not on his game. He must have said that 8-9 times. And I'm like, is Jesse and Rick Rude like best friends?
Jesse would always stump heavily for Rude. Like, he's like a big Rude supporter. I don't know if they were friends or not, but as you'll see as we go
through
these
shows. Isn't that like a Joey Morella thing? Like, they're not related?
No, they're not related. They're both from Minnesota, though, so maybe he felt like a hometown guy, you know?
It could be. Because he's basically making excuses for them, and then, of course, Rude pinned Orndorff.
Yeah, they were kind of feuding a bit.
Out of nowhere, like, Orndorff was like beating the crap out of him, and he just rolls up on him. It always pisses me off. Like, you can kick out a hold 14 times in a row, but then once someone will just get you in it once and that's it.
That becomes definitely an ongoing thing with the Survivor Series. It's kind of a running joke that like moves that you would never lose to in a regular match for some reason hurt more in a Survivor Series setting. like guys lose to clotheslines and shit.
Yeah. I liked Hogan in this match.
Yeah.
He didn't get a lot of wrestling time, as it turned out, but he had like this really cool flying knee move.
Yeah,
which I haven't seen Hogan like fly through the air very often, but he sort of like hit Rude with it. He sort of threw him off the ropes, and he jumped up and got his knee up into the guy's face. I was like, "Yeah, big guy's got some aerial skills."
Taking in the air,
yes, indeed.
So, what do you think of Hogan getting counted out?
Well, I could see it coming. I'm like, maybe that whole first Hacksaw Jim Duggan thing was like a precursor.
Yeah.
He's out there. He's body slamming all these guys. He's like, "Oh, look at me! I can body slam these heavy guys." And I'm like, "Well, this has got to be it." And there it is. I'm like, "What? Where's the big payoff?"
Were you expecting?
We spent all this time between WrestleMania 3 waiting for Andre and Hogan, and now it's over.
Were you expecting it to be like the odds against Hogan?
I'm sitting there and I'm pissed off. What?
Were you expecting it to be like the odds against Hogan? You know, like him down 3-1 or whatever? Like heading into this, is that what you expected?
Yeah, I thought it would be like Hogan would be like reverse Honky and actually win.
Yeah.
But no, there he goes, and he's sitting there in the stage, and I'm like, all right, I'm sitting here, I've watched the Survivor Series for 2 hours, and one thing that has really amazed me, given all the complications that happen in these matches, is that anytime Finkel says, this guy is out, they just disappear. They just run away into the freaking locker room, and there's Hulk Hogan shaking his head. I'm like, dude, you're out. You got to get out of there.
He is
like
a baby.
Bam Bam needs to do his thing. And he's like hanging out. And then they actually, which is, I guess it was intentional because as I'm thinking of that, and also if Hulk Hogan does not get out of the ring, everyone will lose. So that was kind of disappointing, man. It was unbecoming. Hulk Hogan's supposed to be a champion.
All right, well, keep in mind his actions here as we move forward.
Okay. So then you got Bam Bam against the Three Giants. And I thought this was really cool. Because there was like a lot of really cool moves. Once Hogan went out, like there was a really big clothesline that Bundy hit Bigelow with. Like flipped over. And then he throws him against the ropes. And he like kicks the bottom of his legs. And Bigelow does like the spinny thing. And I'm like, damn. Bigger guys are more fun to watch. It's like the opposite of boxing. Like in boxing, little guys are better to watch because they're faster. And like back in the Lennox Lewis days, like those fights were all boring. These guys are just clobbering each other. And it's not like an easy, like, oh, here's, you know, the Big Show and Mayweather. They just have to, everything has to be a gimmick whenever someone gets hurt. It's like, oh, you got this one guy clotheslining a 300-pound guy, 400-pound guy, whatever. Clotheslining another 400-pound guy. And they just like, bam, like go down. I was like, I thought that was cool. So the ending was really fun.
Yeah, I did like the tease of it. I agree with you where it looked like he was going to pull it off. And then I thought it made Andre look like a badass where he just comes in and just crushes him. And just gets to win. And I thought it was cool that Andre kind of got his moment, though. Like, I know you were hoping for more of the Hogan-Andre, but they were dragging it out a bit. And I like that Andre, you know, like WrestleMania, he lost, and he's kind of lost a bunch in the feud with Hogan, like just in the big spot. Like, I thought it was cool that he kind of gets his moment here on pay-per-view. You know what I mean? Like, he gets his big win and gets to celebrate for a minute. And then Hogan comes back, and you get the live crowd gets to get their moment because Hogan knocks him out and poses. Did you care for that ending?
No, that was another douchey move. Totally douchey. I mean, Andre won. It was the main event. He's the survivor. He said he was going to be the survivor, and he was. And all of a sudden, Hogan comes in. They start playing his music. He starts doing his little hands in the air crap, and the crowd's going crazy. Like, no, that's not fair. Andre won. He deserves the spoils. And then you got Gorilla saying he's the best athlete in the world right now. Like, he just lost. Also, it's 1987. What about Mike Tyson? What about Michael Jordan?
He's the greatest professional athlete in the world today.
I don't know about that, Gorilla. I'm going to come out of retirement, and I'm going to beat him myself. This guy is the lowest of the low. Only in Cleveland will they cheer the loser. That's such a funny jab at Cleveland.
It definitely is. All right, any more thoughts on this match?
So basically it has no bearings, anything. It's just like this one thing in isolation. Like Andre won, and it doesn't matter like that you have Andre and the Jumping Bomb Angels and the Killer Bees. Like, just does Andre win the night? Or is it just... whatever.
No, it's match by match. So Andre, he's a survivor of their match. I mean, it's just wins and... This is a time where wins and losses just meant something. It meant, like, in theory, in kayfabe, in the storylines, that the more wins you get, the more impressive you become, and you have shots at being a champion, and money was on the line in all these matches, so if you won, you got more of the purse money. Like, that was always what the story was in you know, this time period.
Well, I just a little cheated, because I thought, kind of like when you made me watch the tournament that Savage won, where he had to fight, like, seven times.
Yeah.
I thought at the end, all of the winners of these matches would fight until there was only one survivor. I think that would be cool.
So they do kind of do that in a few years once.
Does this have any implications on, like, future title fights?
No.
This is Thanksgiving. Are there any fights of significance in 1987?
Not really.
Are we just going on towards 1988?
Well, there is one thing of 87 we're going to show, but it's not a match.
Well, I thought Andre summed it up pretty good in his post-fight interview. He said, "It takes a smart guy to be a survivor." Andre the Giant, genius.
Do you think, is this the worst, is the most, I won't say worst, is it the most disappointing show you've watched so far? I haven't really heard you act like you've wasted time before, and this feels like the first time. You're kind of like, I feel like you're secretly angry with me for making you watch it.
No, I'm not going to say that, because I probably watched it about twice, and I really kind of hated the tag team fight. But I liked the first fight, I liked the last fight, and I liked the female fight. I thought there would be a more momentous format that tied it all together. So I guess I was just kind of like disappointed that it ended so abruptly.
Right.
I mean, I found it entertaining.
Okay. Are you glad that Hogan and Andre's continuing?
Yeah. Right, I mean, good. it took away the mystique of Hogan a little bit.
Yeah, kind of made him look like a bitch.
You know what? I like mystique, and I don't know what I'm rooting for. I mean, apart from hating people and making jokes, like Hogan was like the last pure thing, and now it's kind of like tainted, I guess.
Well, maybe it's just a broken man. Maybe Bobby Heenan has won the war, right? He's turned all his friends against him. He's not the same. He lost his innocence, you know what I mean?
Bobby Heenan can't win shit. The guy was wearing a blue Little League baseball banquet jacket.
He was. Satin.
What the fuck is that?
Hogan's like Billy Mumfrey. He was a wide-eyed optimist.
Too enthusiastic. What a happening it was, though.
Yeah, it was a happening. All right, so do you want to continue on this trek through wrestling?
Yes. Ironically, the angrier I get, the more interested I am.
Okay, great. So we'll see. We'll test that theory. I don't want to spoil what our next one is. I want it to be a surprise for the fans. So stay tuned. We're hoping to do it kind of soon. We'll see. Hopefully your arm will be better soon and we can do this in person. I feel like that's kind of our specialty. Hopefully everyone enjoyed listening. Be sure to check out PlaceToBeNation.com. Subscribe to all of our iTunes feeds, PlaceToBeNation Wrestling, PlaceToBeNation Pop, and Pro Wrestling Only. It is the holiday season, and if you're shopping for gifts, which I know you are, just go to PlaceToBeNation.com/Amazon, and that takes you right to Amazon.com. We get a little bit of credit when you make some purchases, so that would really help us out. So do that if you can. Jeffrey, any final words before we wrap up?
Yes. Remember, it is the law to yield to pedestrians in the crosswalk.
Not from my vantage point, Jess.
Well, come on. You gotta be kidding me, Gorilla.
All right, we're out. Go eat your sandwiches. Go eat your sandwiches.
They can't do their podcast. They can't bring sandwiches to their friends.
Happy Thanksgiving, everyone. He was dirty from head to toe. And when it came his time to pay, I couldn't believe what I heard him say. Sir, I wanna buy these shoes for my mama, please. It's Christmas Eve and these shoes are just her size. Could you hurry, sir? Daddy says there's not much time. You see, she's been sick for quite a while, and I know these shoes will make her smile, and I want her to look beautiful if Mama meets Jesus tonight. They counted pennies for what seemed like years, and the cashier said, son, there's not enough here. He searched his pockets frantically. Then he turned and he looked at me. He said, Mama made Christmas good at our house, though most years she just did without. Tell me, sir, what am I gonna do? Somehow I've gotta buy her these Christmas shoes. So I laid the money down. I just had to help him out. And I'll never forget the look on his face when he said, Mama's gonna look so great. Sir, I wanna buy these shoes for my mama, please. It's Christmas Eve and these shoes are just her size. Could you hurry, sir? Daddy says there's not much time. You see, she's been sick for quite a while, and I know these shoes will make her smile, and I want her to look beautiful if Mama meets Jesus tonight.
There's not much time. You see, she's been sick for quite a while, and I know these shoes will make her smile, and I want her to look beautiful if Mama meets Jesus tonight.
I want her to look beautiful if Mama meets Jesus tonight.